All right, today I'm teaching a live course with School of Cards. So I'm gonna be running a little bit late for that, so can't talk to you guys too much. But basically it's for our PATH members, which is our monthly subscription. It gives you access to every School of Cards course, access to our Slack group, and every monthly live webinar that we run, which right now is 5. There's also student-run study groups, a lot of good hand history discussion and all kinds of poker talk over there. If you're primarily a live player, you should definitely check out School of Cards, especially if you've kind of neglected your study game over the last, month with COVID. Now's the time to get back into it. And if you've been studying hard, then kudos to you, but can't hurt to check it out. We have a lot of good free content as well. So if you want to head over to schoolofcards.com, be my guest and feel free to take our assessment. We'll give you sort of a free suggestion about where your game should be headed and where your focus needs to be. But yeah, I'm running late, so I gotta go.
Deviations really require a deeper intrinsic understanding of like what are the strengths and weaknesses of certain hand types, what can they accomplish, what are their incentives. So like a hand like pocket fives functions just very differently than a hand like 8-7 suited.
What's up everybody, my name is Matt Vaughn. Don't get in an uproar about it. And in today's episode, I'm gonna be recapping a win PLO session I played. Technically, I played some No Limit beforehand. I played a little bit of 1-3 waiting for the PLO seat. It was supposed to be another social day with Steve, but Steve had to bail, something about his dog. Everything's okay, but he skipped town basically. He skipped town on me. It's fine, it's no big deal. But I went to the win to try out some of their 1-2 PLO with a $5 bring-in. That means that instead of limping, you have to make it 5 if you come in. It means the pot limit raise is something like $15 first in. And yeah, I've been playing a lot of PLO. I'm also thinking about making a session I played of 5-10 PLO on ColorUp into a vlog. If you guys are interested in seeing that, let me know in the comments down below. It was like my biggest winning session ever, and I got several hands on video just recording my play. So if you're interested in seeing that, comment down below. Also, if you're interested in playing ColorUp Poker, we host games over there. I have a great community on Discord where a lot of us play there. Right off the bat, you can get 40% rake back. And if you play a decent amount, our promotions usually allow you to get up to maybe 70% rake back. So pretty great deal. Games are good. It's mostly PLO right now, but there's some no limit PLO, some straight no limit hold'em, anywhere from micros up to 5-10 sometimes. I was a little bit nervous coming into this session because I knew that I hadn't played PLO in a live setting in a really long time. Live PLO has really always been my nemesis. I came up playing it in round by round in home games and always had fun. When I went to Pottawatomie when I used to live in Madison, Wisconsin and played PLO as its own game, I got killed. I'm talking my first 13 sessions in a row, I didn't book a win once. Not one single win in 13 sessions. And I was kind of turned off of live PLO since. So when my name was called for the 1-2 $5 bring-in game, with some trepidation, I picked up my chips from the 1-3 no limit table and moved over to PLO. After folding quite a bit, I finally find a moment to get involved. In this hand, I have $600 in my stack and I open ace, king, king, 10 in early position to 15. The button says 15 is not enough, but 45 is too much. I make it 30. I pretty much have no idea what's going on at this point, so naturally, I call. The flop comes out queen jack 4 with 2 hearts and 1 club, so pretty good board for me with the wrap. I also have a small overpair, so when I check, I'm considering my options between calling and raising versus bet. However, he just checks it behind, so we go to the turn 7 of diamonds, still heads up. I check again, expecting that it's gonna be a little bit hard to really get action from worse here, and I can still pretty easily check call. The button now bets 50, so as planned, I put in the call. The river's the 8 of clubs, I check, and they bet 165. I'm really struggling to put them on a hand here. I'm not really sure what bluffs or value there even are, but with my blockers and the fact that he checks the flop, I decide to call. He has 10-9XX, so he does have a straight, it kind of makes more sense in my head now once I see the cards. Probably could have gotten rid of this one. This point, I top offer 500 and play some other interesting hand that I didn't manage to take notes on and wasn't able to record. And then I rebuy another 300 because I must have lost that one too. But in this next hand, I've got 700 in the stack. I open ace jack 10 deuce on the button to 15 and the small blind and big blind call. The flop is favorable. It's favorable indeed. It comes 10-10-3, so we flop ourselves the top trips, and the small blind doesn't want to wait for me to see that. He just leads right out for 30. The big blind now calls, and we have an interesting decision here. I think that with the stack sizes as they are, it's going to be pretty clear cut here to raise, get it in. We can get it in against a lot of worse 10x hands, and the board is likely to only get worse from here. So I make it 130, and somehow only the big blind calls. So the small blind who leads folds, and the big blind calls. The turn is the 8 of clubs. He checks and only has 165 behind, so we're looking at around a half pot bet left. So I stick it in, and he snaps. It's not really a problem yet. I would expect that he would snap with any 10 pretty much in his range. So I'm pretty excited when the river comes a deuce that is very unlikely to connect with him. However, he has jack 10, 8, 7, so we lose another one, and we rebuy for another 400. So far, this is feeling a lot like my old PLO sessions live, where I just lost 13 in a row. Next hand, 800 in the stack, I open the button for 15 with ace 10, 7, 4, double suited. The big blind is the only caller, so he heads it to a flop of jack 4, deuce. Not a ton going on for us here, but we do have a flush draw and middle pair, so when the big blind checks, I put out a bet of 25. She calls, and we go heads up to a turn, which is the 10 of spades. So pick up two pair here, and when she checks, I decide to c-bet 65. At this point, I have the nut flush draw and two pairs, so seems a little bit too weak to check back. She, however, says, "Your 65 is too weak." I make it 250. I decided to make the call because I didn't think three betting is a massive overplay of this hand. She's mostly repping sets, and we don't really want to bloat this pot without seeing what the river is. The river comes, the king of diamonds. She checks, and unfortunately, we're going to have to check this back and probably lose most of the time. We could potentially bluff, but we're holding a lot of the cards we'd want her to have and miss with. So I just check it back, and she has king, king, jack 10. So she did, in fact, turn a better hand. River's an even better hand, but can't go for value because of all the straights. Tough one here, and we're just chipping down perpetually. In this next hand, we've got 400 in the stack and middle position limps. For 5. I open the hijack to 20 with king, queen, 7-7, triple suited. This is probably a little bit questionable. I think an overlimp or a fold would both be reasonable, but with my position at the table, I decided I prefer to maybe try to butt people out of the pot here. The big blind comes along as well as the limper, and the flop comes 4-4 deuce with 2 clubs. Checks to me, and I decide to c-bet 20. I just want to fold out hands that have a decent amount of equity. So I make it 20, and they both call. The turn is the king of hearts, so I improve my one pair holding here. Technically, it's two pair, but it improves to a slightly better two pair. And I c-bet $60, still trying to sort of clean up my equity, not expecting to get check raised here pretty much ever when the flop is just called around. Only the limper calls this time, though, and the river is a jack. He checks, I check it back, and I beat 5-5-3 deuce. So, as expected, people just really messing around here with hands that shouldn't be out there. That's live PLO for you, but it's nice to book my very first winning hand of the session. This next hand, $700 in the stack. There's a limp, and I open the button with ace 8-7-5 with nut hearts. The big blind calls, and the limper calls, so we go three ways. Flop comes queen 8-6 with two hearts, so I have a pretty connected hand here. Open-ended, the nut flush draw, and a pair. I go for a c-bet of 40, and only the big blind calls. We're heads up to the turn, which is an ace, giving me two pair. She now checks, and I bet 150. She makes the call pretty quickly. On a river 7, she leads for 265. So on this card, it doesn't bring in a flush, but it brings in quite a few straights, many of which she can definitely have. 9-10 with side cards that connect with the board is one that makes a ton of sense. And even though we just seem to keep improving with our exact hand, just keep adding pairs over and over again, it's really hard to see us beating much. We also once again find ourselves in a position where having the nut flush draw means it's a little bit less likely she has those kinds of hands that can sort of turn into a bluff randomly on the river. Her sizing also doesn't seem like a bluff either, so I just let it go. kind of unfortunate, and I'm rebuying for 400 once again. In this hand, 650 in the stack, and honestly, I'm a bit tilted. Nothing's really been going my way, all the big pots have gone to other players, and I've only picked up a small pot here and there. In this hand, the button makes it 15, and I'm in the small blind with King-Queen 10-5 double suited. Not necessarily a standard 3-bet spot, but again, a little bit tilted. I make it 50, the big blind cold calls, and the button flats. Flop is 10-9-4 rainbow, so we have ourselves top pair. It's a spot where we could absolutely just look to get this in at these depths. I'm covered by both players, and it's a spot where we're playing a pretty bloated SPR. But I think the best way to do that is maybe check and possibly get it in, possibly call, depending on sizings. Checks to the button, who basically pots it for 150, and I pot it to 600, which is, you know, basically the rest of my stack. Big blind folds, and the button snap calls. The turn is the 8 of spades. The river is the 7 of diamonds, so we just have a 10 on pretty much the worst board ever, but he turns over just a 4 for some reason. So even though like it's unclear if he's trying to say he has just a 4 or whatever, I decide to just show. Then I announce that I just have a 10.
Just a 10.
I say several more times that I just have a 10 because he's tanking forever, and I just keep saying I have a 10. Now, granted, this is from several weeks ago. We're both masked up. There was plexiglass in play. So, you know, with this, it seems like he just doesn't tell what I have, because then he eventually turns over pocket aces with the 4. So he has ace-ace 4 deuce, which he doesn't 4-bet pre, in what I think was a pretty slam dunk spot with these stack sizes in play. Terrible board for him, and he was pretty excited to get it in, but what can you really do? We actually had a lot of equity when this hand went in. I think it's important to remember this when we lose hands like that, because it can be pretty frustrating otherwise. Now, the streak continues. I just don't win at live PLO, it seems. So online PLO, it's a little different. So if you want me to make that online session I was talking about earlier into a vlog, let me know in the comments down below. Now remember, guys, there are a few ways that you can help this channel grow. Number one, you can subscribe and watch a bunch of videos of mine. Number two, you can share this video with a friend. And number three, you can comment and like for the algorithm. Even if you got nothing to say, just comment algorithm, and I'll know who's with me here. Thank you guys so much for watching. This was a kind of fun session, but a little bit of a frustrating one as well. So let me know if you'd like to see more PLO content like this going forward. I promise that the angle of the table footage will get better. I'll have more hands recorded in the future. This was like one of my first sessions back trying to actually record. So I really hope you were able to bear with me on that. I'm signing off. Always remember, just triple.